Hello all, welcome to this course in Computer Organization. The topic that we will be dealing today is a multi-cycle processor. Let's get started. First, we'll be going through the weakness of a single cycle processor. If you're not aware of a single cycle processor or the designing of its data path, I request you to kindly go through my previous videos on the same. While designing a single cycle data path, we came across three primary weaknesses. The first one was that it required a clock cycle that is long enough to support even the slowest instruction, even though most of these instructions are faster. Let's take the example of a load instruction. If there is a delay for the load instruction to fetch the instruction that you require from the memory, then that can affect the total execution time there. So in short, it will all depend upon the longest clock cycle present there. The second point was it required three adders, one for the ALU and two for the program counter logic. I hope you came across this when we were designing the same for a single cycle processor. So here the adders are relatively expensive, especially when they need to be faster. The third point is that it has separate instruction and data memory, and that may not be very realistic because we know that most of the computers have a single large memory that holds both the instruction and data, and that can be read and written as required. Let's see how multi-cycle processor is solving these issues. First step is being addressed by breaking the instruction into multiple shorter steps. For each short step, the processor can read or write memory or a register file or use an ALU. So different instructions use different number of steps. So simpler instructions can complete faster than more complex ones. Also, here the processor uses only one adder, and it is reused for different purposes on different steps. Also, here they use a combined memory for instruction and data. Here the instruction may be fetched from memory in the first step and the data may be read or written in the later steps. And let's look into the designing of a multi-cycle processor. We see that the steps are the same as that of single cycle processor. We begin with constructing a data path that is connecting the architectural state elements and memories with combinational logic. Here the architectural state elements are your program counter and register file. Also here we add non-architectural state elements to hold intermediate results. Then we design a controller whose function is to produce different signals on different steps during the execution of a single instruction. Since it produces different signals on different steps, we model it as a finite state machine rather than a combinational logic. So why is it so? Before that, what is a finite state machine? Throughout, we were discussing about synchronous sequential circuits. What is their specialty? They change the states for every rising edge of the clock cycle based on the input. So this behavior we represent using a graphical form called a state diagram. And the state diagram can be called a finite state machine when it has finite number of states. We'll come across this finite state machine in the future videos that I'm going to do. Next, let us see the state elements again that we are going to use for the designing of the multi-cycle data path. As we discussed in the weakness of a single cycle data path, there we used only two separate components as instruction and data memory, and here we are combining them as one. The major reason for doing so is that in single cycle processor, we needed to write the instruction and the memory or read to memory all in one cycle. So That is why we used it separately in single cycle processor. Whereas here, the design of combining both is more feasible because we can read the instruction in one cycle and data may be read or written to it in a separate cycle. You can see that the program counter and the register file will remain unchanged. And let's brief up on how we concluded that these state elements should have so and so pins here. Let's begin with the program counter. You know, program counter is carrying the address of the instruction to be executed. That is PC. PC is the value. And while we designed, we saw that after traversing to the data path, the updated address will be loaded to PC dash. PC dash will point to the address of the next instruction, that is current PC plus 4. This is the input and this is the output. And you have an enable signal here in case you need to connect it to an external control signal and a clock is present because it is synchronous. Let's look at memory, both instruction and data memory. Memory as such can be read or written. So you have one read pin and one write pin. At a time, only one of it should happen. So whether it's read or write, you need an address. To where should you write or from where should you read? So you have an address pin A. And to know whether it's a read or write that is going on, we have a write enable pin, which will be high when it's a write and low when it's a read. And a clock, of course, because it's a synchronous circuit. Then the register file. All the instructions we discussed till now, they have two source registers and one destination register. So in total, you need three address pins. A1, A2 and A3. From that, two will be source and one will be destination. Two source means you'll be reading from those two registers, so you need two read pins. Destination means you'll be writing to that particular register and you need one write pin. So that is why A1 will read the value to RD1, A2 will read the value to RD2 and A3 will be the address of the register to which the value in WD3 should be written. Here also we have write enable to know whether it's a read or write and a clock since it's a synchronous circuit. So with these data in mind, let us go to the designing of multi-cycle data path in the next video. So that's all for now. Thank you. Thank you for listening.